question.
Oh, okay.
Order!
met with the chief fire officer who was there on site and controlling the scene, and he, in essence, set a term we'd probably use called battle rhythm. So in essence, I suppose, we, certainly myself as the council officer who responded at that time, I probably defaulted to the experience of the chief fire officer who was in place on that location at that time, dealing with the acute phase of that incident. We, at that stage, didn't know, and he didn't know, whether there were people missing or what the scale of the whole event at the time. But in essence, he was the lead officer in terms of that event. So if he called the incident and managed that incident as he saw fit as the lead agency, I suppose, in terms of that acute phase. So there was a meeting of people on site and on scene at that time, but in my experience, that was different than what would normally be a strategic coordinating group. Normally, you're quite correct, a strategic coordinating group is called. There's normally a meeting in one of those pre-identified locations. It's normally Bridal Road, the Command and Control Centre. It's normally the police or the fire will lead that. And we would normally, in those instances, execute or ask a member of the senior leadership team to go there and represent the council. Having said that, there was David and myself on scene on that site at that time, but it didn't feel like, and you know, I discussed this with yourself, Councillor Bird, at the time, it certainly didn't feel like a traditional or a typical strategic coordinating group, but I think that was because, like I said, the chief fire officer was there managing the scene on that site, and in reality, as a council officer, I defaulted to that experience of dealing with those emergencies.
And I think that's going to be quite crucial because he was the most senior officer there, clearly he's the chief fire officer, and he had ownership of the site. In the same way that when I've been to many school fires over the years, the fire brigade had charge of the site during that critical phase. What we did was make sure that we were providing with everything he wanted. So he asked for those approaches and we organised those. He asked for planting equipment to move some of the people off the roads. Not all of them, because of course we were mindful that it may become seen to be held by the police. But he wanted some roadways through the rubble to get ordinary vehicles, the dashboard vehicles and so on. And we organised that. And when he was satisfied that we couldn't provide him with anything else, Mark and I then went off to help down the road centre and start to do all we could down there. So I mean, technically, sometimes we then have to sign, even when it's our site, we have to sign when it's given back to us by the fire service. So that was the position. A, make sure that he had what he needed from us, and then B, go and help where we could with the people who would be in this place.
Thank you for that. Just on the terms of the debriefing for February 18th, there doesn't seem to be certainly aware that there's more pot alarm, which clearly has a charge set against it. It's part of the strategic acquisition programme that now we're in to try and create some new redevelopment opportunities. We have recently been with that particular landowner.
Yeah, we've currently reached an agreement in terms of the properties where the blast took place. We've actually got one that's 14, that's the ability to sign, that's quite straightforward. We've got three where we've got agreement and they're illegal. We've got a provisional agreement with the blast site itself. We've got one other where we've got agreement. So around the blast area, we've actually made some progress. It's proving to be more difficult with the properties on the main road in terms of our starting point and the other starting points. In terms of our, obviously we're going to be watching over until we sort of
thank you, Chair. Can I also thank everyone who was involved and all the help that was given? Reading reports and so forth, and see multiple agencies were involved and all helping out in the best way we could. Just a couple of questions regarding the response recommendations 1, 3, 4, and 5, mental health and welfare. Some victims are saying that mental health provision is still needed now. If the council identified additional needs for victims, are specialist mental health services now needed? So second question, many victims are dealing with more than one major life challenge at the same time. Physical injuries, trauma, loss of their home, livelihood, relationships, and mental health, plus uncertainty, spiralling debt, insurance delays, criminal investigations, while departments and agencies were dealing with their own remits. Was there a victim-centred approach? Was advocacy and victim support provided?
Please be careful.
Sorry?
I did mention that you need to be careful when you use the phrase legal proceedings. Please be careful. I don't want to go on the wrong.
No, well,
I understand what you're talking about. I can say categorically that our community forum on three occasions were addressed by two ladies from the UK area in relation to issues of mental health and the opportunity to get more support. I know it was taken by officers at the time. What the outcome from that was, I can't even answer because it's not the area. But I do know that those issues were raised on more than one occasion by community representatives. Now, ex-councillor on the board, because he was actually dealing with those ladies at that particular time. So it would have been beneficial.
Yeah. The questions around obviously the emergency services, the NHS, and other professionals, not the elected councillors, providing mental health that was needed. My question is, was it adequate? Was it provided? And is there still a need for it now? I don't know what the involvement of what involved was.
Yes.
What is professional criteria was around that?
As board council, we brought that issue to the fore in at least three forums that we held. That's all from the
some particular vulnerable victims needed translation, interpretation to understand and respond what was happening. Was that language support provided? Recovery recommendation 4. What support and training has been delivered for responders, especially not the blue light people? So, reading the reports, one of the things that stuck out to me was that during the response stage, and except after a disaster, you know, people are running around to a certain extent and trying to help the best they can. But I think victims were saying in the reports that they found it difficult to have one-to-one interviews in private with anybody. And I think that's absolutely, it's not for me to say it's essential, but I could imagine that's something that's really needed, you know, because people don't want to disclose private situations, and if they're not given the facility to do that, that will just add to the mental health problems that obviously we've seen.
And just before you answer, I hope a lot of those people in that situation will have approached their GP as well to get the required help that they needed. And of course, proximity was quite perhaps slowly using the Indian pay. So, you know, I take your point.
In terms of the health provision, during the acute phase, there are pretty clear tried and tested plans from all those agencies who make up that multi-agency response. And in terms of the Life Church, which is where the Survivor Reception Centre was open, and it was open before officers from the council arrived, the community themselves had opened that facility, so we supported that facility as best we could in terms of assisting them. But there were ambulance crews and medics in that facility at least for the first 24-36 hours dealing with people who were presenting at the Life Centre, and there was also a number of people who self-presented to the A&E or the walk-in centres as well. But so in essence, for the immediate concern, the psychological and trauma bits would be immediate shock from being involved in an instance of that nature, and it would be about dealing with shock at that situation. The more latent issues that present themselves around more medium to long-term mental health conditions and from that trauma, in some ways, the chair is quite right. We would hope and expect that those would be picked up through the local GPs and people presenting themselves there. But I'm aware that there were health representatives at all of the public meetings during that recovery phase as well, or certainly most of them. So again, people could have raised things at that position as well. Now, David isn't here, and David Ball was here, and chair, each of those would be able to answer that more fully, but that's my understanding of it. I think in terms of...
Can I just come in there? You said that there were public meetings, and my specific question was around one-to-one private intervention.
Sorry, Chair, I was going to get on to that question. I was just setting the context in terms of the acute phase and the recovery phase. In terms of those private one-to-one meetings, like I said, I'd expect those to have been predominantly dealt with through the one-to-one meetings with GPs and general practitioners, as people realise that their health's been affected by that incident. When that should stop and how that should stop and those services, I'm not in a position to be able to answer what we've got in terms of Wirral, in terms of those, because that's really a question that I suppose needs to be raised with the NHS around mental health welfare provision, because that's the area it would have fell in, really. And I know from attending a number of these committees that there are concerns about those services, but I wasn't made aware during any of that post phases that there would be to mental health services any more or any less above what the other populace is around England at that point?
I think in terms of the foundation, it's a point you make in the same document acknowledges it. It would have been better if we had could have found accommodation, had some one-to-one accommodation, one-to-one interview accommodation as well. Mm-hmm. I think in terms of the mental health and the health support, we would never bring that to an end because we're not qualified in any way to know how old you would be. So for example, I sat with one lady who thought her house had fallen down behind her, and I knew it hadn't. So I went back down and took some photographs on my phone so I could go back and show them to her and say, well, actually, yeah, things are damaged, but your house is there. And I think, how do I know? How would anybody know? We wouldn't reach a judgment on how long it's going to take that lady to get over that situation. So we haven't done that. So really, it does become a health medical matter between medical professionals and the individuals, really. Because we've never said to anybody, well, actually, the time is right now to end that support. Because we wouldn't, it would be totally inappropriate.
So if I can share, so what you're saying is additional mental health support and provision wasn't available, it was just through their own GPs.
So through the emergency planning process, the on-call gold commander for the NHS that on that period was aware of that incident, and they had plans in place and put plans in place to deal with that. And if they felt, and again, to answer, it's a question I haven't specifically asked that gold commander of fairness, Councillor Norbury, and maybe that's a question you should ask. But ultimately, there was, in terms of this report, a recognition that they, in terms of those people who provide that mental health support, maybe could have done more in terms of that. So with that, I suppose from my side, does that mean they weren't there in place? There were frontline medical practitioners in place for the acute phase of that incident. And when we talk about private premises, the private group and locations being to go to, people went into the back of ambulances to have some of those conversations.
The very important thing was the practical bit, where it wasn't to do with the medical condition, it was to do with finding a way of securing urgent medication where people couldn't go back in their houses. Indeed, another colleague of ours who was there, who volunteered to come from Children's Social Care, that was all sorted out with the health professionals who were on site at the Life Centre, and it was all looked in there at our hospital and pharmacy there. So we did provide support, but we provided all the practical support, not the individual medical needs, because that's what that would probably include.
Can I just point out that people were now reacting to
what they had witnessed, even if they hadn't witnessed any bodies or anything like that, they had witnessed that bang in that road that night, all the way around, because you were kind of trapped in the middle of Birmingham. It was very, very frightening. And it was dark and smoky. What I'm concerned about is that reading through this, and I've looked at page 29, and I've looked at the comments about mine, I think even without any medical knowledge, we would all assume that people who were around them or who then suffered as a result of this explosion will have been affected. Whether that manifested itself in any way that they would assume would be a medical issue, worries about money, worries about how the business is going, arguments with their partners, arguments with people they worked with, everybody on edge, people not being able to open their businesses when clearly there was no reason why they couldn't, because there was no damage to those, all sorts of things that were going on. At that point, I think we must learn to the future that we have something in place which signposts people to the right place. So people are aware of what that stress is, what it is they're actually witnessing. And it is like delayed stress, isn't it? That's effectively what happened to a lot of people. It didn't hit them, the adrenaline's running, it didn't hit them until 2 or 3 months later. And then there was nothing, because everybody was involved in this sort of euphoria, as presented by Councillor Ward, of things that were being done, so people didn't want to say, God, I feel really fed up, because it was a sort of, the communities getting together. And then there was this hiatus of nothingness, and I think that's where we really fell down, but it's a fall down that can be expected in a way, because it's not something that's happened before, but I do feel it's something that we need to say in the future. We must be aware that once the adrenaline stopped, people are going to really start hitting rock bottom, and they're not going to want to say anything. And we see that throughout life. There are people who do not want to say. People don't go to the doctors for things like that. It's okay to say that they do, but people don't. They don't go until it manifests itself far more strongly than that. And that's where I think we could have gone in, where we could have signposted people to all the agencies that there are out there. And I think we did fall down.
I think that is a
recommendation. Can I just say, if all those issues that you're talking about are in the recommendations, and they should be picked up on the other waiting party, because we can see there's a certain amount that needs to. What we've done excellent, but since we've invested, we've now made recommendations to move forward and ratify those. In fact, there's nine recommendations. In the report, even though it's for those in the comments, but I think those issues will be picked up later. We can understand what you're saying, but.
Chair, can I just go back and apologise? This is not my committee,
yes.
As well as the mine environment. But what I'm saying is that recommendations, we have all seen recommendations, and so I would hope that this committee makes sure that they see those recommendations, how they are being enacted, and they scrutinise that as to the appropriateness of it, or whether it's just a taken off the peg, oh look, those do this and those do that, so it's very important. It's too important.
Yeah, it's something that we will look at.
Thank you, Chair. Speaking as a survivor of an explosion myself, I was in a blast-proof room, which I was in there with the blast and the fire. Was on fire. I fully appreciate how PTSD works. I've had PTSD. You might say I still got PTSD. That is the way it works. I don't think for one minute sort it early enough, people will make a quicker recovery and we will be in a better situation 3, 4, 5, 6 months on, because the people will be in a better position 3, 4, 5, 6 months on.
I'd like to ask a question about in relation to the general condition of the site, particularly over recent times and before as well. Many people criticise the most criticism, saying it looks like a sort of blitz reenactment area. We've had, I think, small amounts of funds are being put in there, but I mean, we all know that a visual appearance of an area is really important. And don't you think we could have done a lot more to improve that site on a technical basis? Because, again, it just gets shiny light of dereliction, and it doesn't send a good message out to anyone at all.
I think it's a fair comment that clearly we don't own any of it at the moment, so we have to get good people's permission to go onto their land. But you're right, in the sense that it was clear, and then it was left, and representations were made that it needed to be better, and we've responded to those. It would have been nice if we could have done it sooner. Yes, but it isn't as easy as us just doing what we like to other people's property, other people's land. It does take time to negotiate. We are doing it now, and we're doing what the community wants. And I suggest they want to put volumes on and put children's work and stuff on it, like we've done elsewhere. The community wanted it something different, and we're doing exactly that now. And we've managed to find some funding for it using the same funds that we use for the English clearance. So yeah, again, we all learn things from these. It would be far easier if the land had all been owned by the council. Because it wasn't this interesting case of us going on doing things on other people's land. Some buildings had to be cleared out first, and that took a considerable time to reach agreement so the demolition could take place. And also, we then had to satisfy ourselves. If we were going to encourage people to go on other people's land and we wanted to spend money on it, there are other buildings around it that have also suffered the blast as well. So there were some complications with it.
But just an added question, but that was the key side maybe, wasn't it, that day, from the point of view, and particularly from a visual standpoint. And also, I think, obviously lessons can be learned, I'm sure.
And I think also, we haven't faced this kind of campaign before, and I know that people here whose actual houses it was, but if I use that example I used earlier, whenever I was down in the south of the borough, sometimes I'd look around that way to see if that lady and her husband were back in their house. And it took an awful lot longer than I thought, because clearly, in dealing with a fire damage building or a flood damage building, we know what that process is over the years. These were buildings that suddenly had this impact into them and hooked into all their structural fabric. And again, I think there's a lesson learned from that. It took a lot longer to rectify the problems than perhaps we initially thought it would.
Thanks, Jeff. Again, I'd just like to go back to health division, which numerous colleagues have actually brought up. Whilst primary healthcare is still the responsibility and delivered by the NHS, I think I'm correct in saying since April 2013, the council have actually had responsibility for improving healthcare and the health of the populace. So, therefore, whilst the acute medical attention course being provided by the NHS, I'm sure they did a fantastic job. I don't think it's acceptable to just say, we hope, as the officer did say, we hope that people are seeking help from the GP. That's not actually good enough, and it's incumbent upon us to actually ensure that they are getting the correct medical and mental support. So whilst there's some good recommendations in the report, what are officers doing to ensure that strategic partners are actually improving the health of those individuals?
Chair, so through you, again, if I can draw members' attention to paragraph 4.17 in the recovery variables, you'll see there that there's a bullet point in terms of April that the NHS will initially provide counseling support and therapy services, which would be in addition to that primary care. I accept that point, Councillor. In terms of that, and into that process, really, in terms of people came forward with assistance, that would be the mechanism we would normally expect to be signposted or to be passed through from that provision. But in terms of the ongoing mental health support side, I'd have to ask that question back to the mental health services, because they were the ones that were dealing from that first part of that recovery phase.
Yeah, that's that it can share through you. That, I think that's exactly what I'm saying. I think as part of the recommendations, that needs to be explicitly stated that if God forbid we have any future major incidents like that, that's exactly what we need to be doing. I think it needs to be explicitly stated that we will do it.
Something we've never never seen before, because the conventional fire flood thing, you're not greeted by that sight. And it just took a while to actually work out what had happened, even with the explanations. But I think beyond that, it did then just become a straightforward online, pressing the buttons to get the contractors, the road closures and so on out. It was the impact on the residents that I've never seen before, because if you have a fire on a school site, for example, even a big one like a ferry, it tends to build slowly, it's contained within the site, you might evacuate people, you might ask them to move their vehicles, but actually they were just sat watching the telly or walking around the house, and suddenly, bang, and that was different. I'd never come across that before, so I think we were okay with it once we got our head around what it was we were looking at. And clearly we had the benefit of the chief fire officer to explain it to us, because it took them a little while to get their head around, because their initial reaction was to respond to a blast, and it was when they arrived, I met one of the fire officers,